Today we're going to learn how to create bones in Toonsquid. So just so we can get the fundamentals out first, we're going to learn how to do bones on a stick figure first, and then later in part 2 we'll expand on how to make bones for a whole character. So I'm going to jump straight into it, and I know you guys have been waiting on this tutorial, but it's taken me, this is about my fourth time recording this tutorial because it took me a while to figure it out, but I finally done it. So we're just going to go into our project and go into the path tool, and we're going to make an ellipse. So we're just going to drag and make our head. And then after that, we're going to go to freehand and we're just going to draw the limbs. So we're just going to draw like this, and we're going to actually click in the middle just to make sure we have a middle point for our character to bend. So this is necessary that you have this little point here because it's where your bone will rotate from. So we can just duplicate this to create the rest of the body. But one thing we'll want to do first is in the middle point, we're going to click it and click symmetric, because making it symmetric will basically allow our character to bend when we're using bones rather than look very sharp and unnatural. And we're going to want to make sure that we don't have a fill on. So we're going to make sure this is fully transparent. And then we're good. So we can duplicate this 4 times to create our body. And we can just drag it along. And for my legs, I'll just select the path tool and I'll edit my path to make it longer. And there we go. Here's our stick man. So now we can create bones. Yay. So we're going to actually want to make sure that all of our layers are in a group, which should automatically happen with our vector layers. And we're going to click the top of the group. Even though you can individually put bones on these layers, it's just better to do it in a group. And we're going to open our properties bar on the right. We're going to go to effects and we're going to scroll down to bones. So from here, we're going to find out how to make the body correctly. So what we're going to do is we're going to start from the torso, which will be the base of our body. So we're going to drag up rather than down, because you see this big part of the bone. This is where the bone will rotate from. If we click our bone editing tool, we see that it rotates from the torso right here. So we're going to start from there. Now I'll start it over because we also need to be making sure that we're making children for this bone. So what are children? We're going to drag up twice and the second one will be our child. So if we go to edit bone hierarchy, we'll see that B1 is the parent and anything that's blue is the selected bone, and B2 is the child because it's nested in B1. And basically with children, they will follow whatever the parent does. So if the parent rotates, so does the child. So we're going to go back and we're going to select the second bone we made, and we're going to make children for that bone as well. So we're going to do the arm and we're just going to drag from here, and then without deselecting, so make sure you don't click on the screen because that will deselect your bone. You see it's orange instead of blue. Instead, we want to make sure that we don't deselect because we want it to be a child, and we're going to drag here and we're going to drag again. So we're going to follow this same method for the left arm. We're going to select here, and then we're going to make children. And then we'll do the same thing for the head. And we'll just drag up because we want it to rotate from the neck. Now, with the legs, we're actually going to select our original bone, the torso. and we're going to make that a child of that. And we'll do it again for the right leg. And now we have our character fully moving. Let's test it out. So, to move our bones, if we click the small side of the bone with the triangle, it will rotate it. If we click the circle at the large part, it will move the bone itself. So that's something we'll generally want to avoid unless we're trying to deform our character. And then one more process we can do is we can click enable scale editing, and then we can change the scale of the bone. So we can just make our character have stretchy arms, right? And we can always disable this by clicking disable scale editing. We can also disable position editing so we can only rotate. So if we ever want to edit our bone character, we're just going to click out of our bone tools at the top left, and we can edit our character by bringing up the timeline. We can extend our frames. And then what we actually want to see is the keyframes, not the traditional frames. And then if we just edit our character, so we can actually click on the transform tool and then click on our character and click edit bones to get into the bone tools quickly. And then if we just move our bone on any frame, it will automatically create a keyframe. And we'll see that it's automatically animated on that keyframe. If it doesn't automatically make a movement, we'll just want to make sure that our easing curve is set to a different timing. And then we'll see that our bones are slowly moving. So I'm actually going to set this easing curve to my default easing curve. So every time I move a bone, it will animate easily. Now, as we can see, our head is kind of becoming flat when we're animating it, which is a problem. So the way to fix this is we can delete our keyframes. And then what we can do is we can click on our bone and we can click edit bone binding. Then we can basically just select our head layer. And then we can click bind to bone. And another thing, just for good practice, is that you should also name your layers just so you can keep track of what layer you're editing exactly. Now, another way we could edit our character is we could use hold frames to edit our character frame by frame rather than animating on keyframes. So we could turn on our effects. And if I instead made my primary curve hold and set it as default, then anytime I make a new edit to my bones, they won't take effect until the current keyframe. And we can see, rather than moving in between several keyframes, it gets animated right where I want it to. Now, this would get messy, so I do think there needs to be a better way to do this. And even in the Toonsquid handbook, it said there is another way to do it, but from my test, it has just not worked out, so we can't get into it on this video. Now, another thing you can do with bones is you can just bind an animation layer to bones instead. So we could take off our keyframes here, and then if we open up our properties, we could add effects and add bones. And now we have one bone, and as we can see, we can rotate our whole layer like this. Now, we don't need to do this. We could use animation layer bones the same way we could use bones on our drawing layers. So if we wanted to, we could click edit bone binding and we could bind it to this bone and bind the drawing layer. And now it's moving with the animation layers effects. However, that's not what we're gonna do for this video. I just wanted to show it. Now, another very important thing about bone binding in Toonsquid is inverse kinematics. So inverse kinematics is basically just the ability to control your bones from a different point. So if we want to use inverse kinematics, we're going to always want to select the last child in our bone hierarchy. So if we went to our bone hierarchy, we would see that B11 is a child of B1 and B10. So that's the one we would want to pick. And we'd want to create a new bone, and it doesn't need to be on the body. We'll just select it here and create it. So to clarify, this new bone should be its own parent. It shouldn't be any part of this bone body. We're going to make sure that if we select the bone where we deselect and we create a new parent, and then if we go in our bone hierarchy, we'll see B12 is its own parent. So what we're going to do is we're going to go back to our bone chain, that back to the last child, basically, and we're going to select B12 as the ITK target, because this is the one we're trying to target. And now, when we move this bone, the leg will follow everything in this IK chain, which is basically just a chain of bones, the parent and the child, will follow this inverse kinematic point. And then we'll do the same for this leg. So now we have a new point as a different IK target. It should be B13. We'll set it to B13. And there we go. Now, some things we could do with IK targets are, even though both of these are following the target, they can't really control themselves when we go to edit them. So what we can do is we can click ignored by IK, so we can control the bone on its own. Pretty handy. With parents, we also see that children will follow the rotation of the parent, right? But we can also just select our bone and we can click independent rotation. And now when the parent rotates, the child still tries to hold its position. You see the bone, even though it follows, it doesn't change its rotation. Another thing we can do with inverse kinematics is IK stretching. So what is IK stretching? IK stretching would be if we bring this up, our bone will basically extend itself to wherever our inverse kinematic target is. So if I have it this far and then I go to the child and I put IK stretching on, it will keep going until it reaches the bone. Now, we can't get it too ridiculously long because there is a limit. But as you see, it can stretch quite far. Another thing to know about bones is the skinning mode. If we choose localized, it will be more pointy, as we can see. And if we click smooth, the bones bend to each other. So yeah, that's mainly what you need to know about bones. Oh, one more thing, actually. There's the strength. So basically, if you have your bone set to strength, to zero strength, that will basically not control your drawing. The strength is how much the bone influences your drawing. So if you have it set stronger, it will be able to control your drawing easier. If you have it set to zero, it won't control it at all. It's default set to 1. with the IK target, you'll generally want its strength to be set to 0 to avoid any problems. So now we'll quickly try to do the same thing, but with a raster character rather than Vector. So we're going to add a drawing. And even though raster isn't generally used for bones, we'll just check out the functionality. So I'm going to draw my head. And then I'm going to want to make a separate layer for each limb. Except on this one, I'm actually going to make a separate layer for each part of each limb. So I'm going to separate the shoulder and where the elbow meets. Now we're going to group them all. And we'll add bones. So let's scroll up, add bones. And we'll just make the same thing we did last time. And then let's try and test it out. So one thing we'll notice is, once again, the character is distorting. So with raster drawings, you'll want to make sure you edit the bone binding for each bone. And keep in mind, one layer can have several bone bindings. If you ever want to unbind a bone, you can just click the same thing and click reset bone binding. So the difference with raster characters is they don't stay together the same way that vector characters do. So if we want to make it work, we're going to want to make sure that we're consistently changing our bones and where they're positioned, because they will disconnect from the body when they rotate. But we can still pose it without getting deformations to our character. So yeah, that's it for this tutorial. If you learned anything, please subscribe and hit a like. And if you know anything that could help everyone, just drop a comment. So in part 2, I'm going to go more into making a full character with bones. So I hope you look forward to that. Peace.